We all know that Gen 5 SSDs can be insanely fast, but they can also be insanely expensive. So when a drive like the Crucial P510 comes along and calls itself budget friendly, well, it didn't really call itself budget friendly, I did that, my immediate thoughts would be, well, is or are, what's the catch? Welcome back to the channel, and today we're going to be looking at the Crucial P510, on paper a very respectable Gen 5 drive. Starting off with the basics, it has sequential reads of up to 11,000 megabytes per second and writes of 9,500 megabytes per second. But those big numbers don't tell the whole story. And do note that the different drives have different speeds available, 1, 2, and 4 terabytes. Maybe not 4. Who knows? The biggest compromise that you're gonna find in the P510 is that it's a DRAM-less SSD. And if you want to understand why we have DRAM-less drives, yes, there is a performance difference, but the simple explanation is that it's cheaper. But in my test, the drive did hit all of its promised sequential speeds, but we'll get to this when we go through the results. For single, massive file transfers, it's incredibly fast, but the DRAM-less design makes it feel more sluggish with lots of small, random files. And the reason for this, and as an aside again, is because what DRAM does is it provides a map to say these are where these files are. So when you don't have that map, it takes longer to fetch those files. And yes, SSDs without DRAM can result in games taking longer to load, but more importantly, it does take your system or your operating system longer to boot. But let's run through the results.
Starting off with the specs, it is the P510, as we know, interface NVMe PCIe Gen 5x4. This is 1 terabyte. There are other variants available. Kit quantity, 1 SSD, form factor M.2, 2280, and the endurance is 600 terabytes. Or is it? We'll get to that. Speed and timing, 9,500 megabytes per second for this version. Read, 11,000 megabytes per second. Random read, 1.5 million IOPS. Random write, 1.5 million IOPS. And the warranty will get you up to endurance or the 600 terabytes, but just check your store for the warranty. On the promise, it's 11,000 on read, and then for write, 9,500. Now let's compare that to what we actually got. Crystal Peak hitting over that, just 11,029, so hitting on promise, and write, 9,525. For default, 10,790 for read, and on write, 9,371. For Crystal Real World, however, we got 5,893 on read, and for write, we got 7,526. Crystal Peak 4K is there for your records. For those interested, here are the exact Crystal results. Then for endurance and error checking, we test over 24 hours on ATTO, on different sizes from 512 bytes to 64. We can see this ran for the 1,440 minutes and it achieved pretty good. It was just an anomaly on the 32 megabyte portion where we saw the result dipped, but this is just to show you what it does over 24 hours and what the endurance is going to be, which I'll show you how we calculate that now. But for the temperatures over the 24 hours, it hit a maximum of 60 with an average of 52. We can see the total host writes and reads, which will be verified just now. But note, this was tested with a special cooling unit in the Taichi Carrara X670. But on the left, you will see 0 hours when we just inserted it and 100% health and the temperature. And then over 24 hours, you can see 97%, which is extremely important, and power on card for 28 hours. It will also have the total host reads and writes after for verification. This is where it gets insane, because the drive promises 600 terabytes written for total health. However, after 24 hours, only 3% of the drive's health was utilized. With that in mind, the total writes or host writes within that period would calculate to 2,681 if we had to use 100% of the drive's health, which means that you're going to predictably get 4 times the amount of health with this drive than what is actually promised, which is great. This was verified with a few tests, but I've inserted another one to show you that it's only 3% of the health that's been used. So I checked this with CrystalDisk, with the program that you can see in front of you, with HW Info, and they all said the same thing. So it's reasonably true to expect that this drive is going to last. Then onto some more tests. We have AIDA, and we can see the test suite for OS only on the top and 50% capacity. Not working too much harder at 50% capacity, showing that it's a good drive in this instance. Next, we have linear read, OS only on the left, 50% capacity on the right. The block size changes dynamically. That's why we're going to have different transfer rates. But what we need to look at is the graphs. We could see on the left, it is quite erratic when the operating system is only on, and then it levels out. But at 50% capacity, it's all over the place until the drive actually has no information on it. So this is trying to say that without DRAM, that your access or your linear read of the drive is going to be a bit slower. You probably won't even notice it, but this does show that this is a DRAM-less drive. Buffered read, not much to report here. It is buffered read, so information if you want to look at it. And then random read, where cache is going to have a massive impact, and we can see just how big. Not that bad. It does look really bad, but this is going to have millisecond consequences for a user, unless that user is doing something so specific that they need the smoothness of the system. So for everyday users, this really wouldn't matter too much. And lastly, for AIDA, we have got the millisecond response, which has gone from 2 milliseconds to 7 milliseconds on response. But to see how this would impact you in everyday life, on the top left is a timer. We are transferring around about 450 gigs. Top left is the P510 to a Gen 4. Then on the right-hand side, we've got Gen 4 to the P510. On the bottom left, P510 to P510. And on the bottom right is a hard drive or portable hard drive to the P510. It is important to note that there are very varying types of files, from small files to movie files, from 1 kilobyte all the way up to 2-3 gigabytes. So this would impact the test and the ups and downs that you do see. And then lastly, a 27.4 gigabyte movie file. It was a 6K file, and we can see T710 to T710 on the left and P510 to P510. So a DRAM drive versus this P510 DRAM-less. We can see that the DRAM drive is faster and the P510 is a little bit slower, going through dips because of a caching issue. Then two more tests, Gen 4 to T710 and Gen 4 to P510. There shouldn't be or isn't too much difference between these. We do see a dip on the P510, but for me, this is anomalous. And then last test, where cache is going to have a big impact, because the T710 is going to know where all the information is and the P510 isn't. It's fetching it as SLC cache allows. And we can see this in the speeds, and this is a real-time test, so you could watch this one through to the end.
As you can see from the results, the DRAM-less design is the key trade-off here. It does keep the price low, but it can affect sustained performance and make the drive feel less responsive in some situations compared to more premium counterparts. Then the question becomes, well, who is this drive for and who can benefit from it? And I don't have a blanket recommendation. What I can say, it's for the person who values endurance and wants a taste of what Gen 5 speed is like, but you have to be willing to accept the trade-offs. But the real story for me here isn't the speed, like the T710 that I did, it's the endurance, and it's even more impressive here, as you saw in the results. Now, a lot of people might be saying, well, why aren't you talking about the price? And there's a very good reason for that. This drive costs different amounts in different countries all over the world, and the different markets have different competition drives. So you need to take this and see what this does and compare it to your local market. I can tell you that in South Africa, it's very good value for money, but you do have to look all over the world and say, okay, for this speed and this endurance, am I getting what I want? And what are the comparisons out there, or comparatives out there? And then make your own conclusions. But again, as a call it coverall, it is good value for money, considering what you're getting. So what's my final take on the P510? It's not perfect, and it does have compromises, but it delivers on its promise of a budget-friendly Gen 5 drive with some surprising strengths. The big question then becomes, would you trade off some of the high-end features for a lower price point and incredible longevity? But let me know what you think and what your thoughts are in the comments. That's what Think and Thoughts are, but do it. Look forward to seeing you in the next one. Cheers, goodbye.